Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of The Two Deaths of Ruth Lyle by Nick Louth, narrated by Mandy Weston. Chapter 1. Saturday, 7 p.m. Good. Bang on time. The suspect's car, a dark BMW estate, slid into the car park of the Royal Oak. It was a carefully chosen rendezvous. A village 10 minutes south of Barnstable, where she wouldn't be recognised. Detective Inspector Jan Talantire watched from her own darkened vehicle in the shadow of the pub's gable. Ignition off, no lights. She was just 30 yards away, but able to scribble down the registration number in her pad. 6 years old, one rear brake light not working. The BMW came to rest in the position she had expected, opposite the lounge, nose towards the pub so the driver could see in. The suspect was silhouetted in the glare of the pub window, broad-shouldered, hair short at the sides, shaped above, and a neat beard. Her electronic intel looked correct, so far. She waited as he emerged from the car. Tall, tight trousers that gripped at thigh and calf, some kind of formal jacket. He made his way round to the rear of the vehicle and opened the boot, bent over whatever was inside, both hands busy, smiling and apparently talking to himself. Interesting. The suspect locked the vehicle, then made his way empty-handed into the pub, wiped his feet carefully, and could soon be seen through the front window. He took a seat within view of his vehicle. Clearly wary, no drinkers yet. A bit nervy, perhaps. Good. He appeared to think the stakes were high. So did she. Things had gone on long enough. Weeks of research, swiping through mugshots, chasing down leads. The inevitable disappointments when a promising line of inquiry came to naught. She had just 10 minutes to wait. Her decision. A policy. She risked the interior light, which she was pretty sure could not be seen from inside the pub, and took a final glance in the mirror at her disguise. Long, indulgently dangly earrings, chestnut hair, highlighted just yesterday, full-bodied, down at her shoulders, the work ponytail banished. Eye makeup, fairly extensive eyeshadow, eyeliner underneath to emphasise her big blue eyes, and lipstick. Not the full crimson, but a softer shade, which she reapplied quickly. A small handbag containing both work and personal phones. She took a quick glance at each, then switched them off. It was something she rarely did, but this time it was essential not to be disturbed. She smoothed down her black zip-up skirt. It was a shortish number, which she rarely wore, and which now didn't seem a great idea. She checked her lap for crumbs from the cereal bar she had gulped down as a precaution against a rushed exit, then slid down the sleeves of her white blouse and added a bracelet. Nothing flashy, but smart. She pulled off her flat work shoes and slid on the royal blue high heels she had kept in the passenger footwell. That would add a couple of inches to her height, making her 5'10". She saw the suspect check his watch. 2 minutes to go. Okay, time to make her move. She slid out of the door into the April chill, walked gingerly around the puddles, and made her way to the pub entrance. The warmth of the place stood over her as she turned to the table. She was within 5 yards before he looked up. A cautious smile.
"Hi, you must be Jan," he said, standing up and offering his hand.
Nice smile, great teeth. His profile said over 6 feet, but he was barely taller than she was, 5'11 at most. A lie, but maybe a forgivable one. He hadn't lied about his age, though. That looked spot on.
"Glad to meet you, Adam. I'm sorry I'm a bit late."
It was deliberate, a calibrated time to build expectations.
"I hadn't noticed."
Liar, but a nice liar.
"Glass of wine?"
he asked, getting ready to head to the bar.
Imposing expectations. Not so good. I see they have an oatmeal stout, so I'll go for half of that. Her first challenge. He hid his surprise well. She sat and looked down at the menu, but with a sidelong glance, checked him out as he headed to the bar. Yes, the trousers were tight, but at least properly belted. Firm bum, clearly fit. Some kind of stain near the vent of his jacket. She told herself to turn it off. She wasn't at work now, despite the meticulous preparation. But still, she saw him looking back at her reflection in the bar mirror. A good sign. Back with the drinks, he sat down, looked through the menu and asked,
"Did you say you were a vegetarian?"
She laughed. No, not at all. You must be mixing me up with someone else. He probably had a few dates on the go, but right there was a beginner's mistake.
Sorry,
he laughed and flexed his eyebrows in acknowledgement. That attractive smile again. She found herself grinning back at him. Steady on, Jan. This is date one, 5 minutes in. The pan-fried pork chop with garlic mash is very good here, she said.
Garlic?
He asked, leaving the rest unspoken. Flirtatious. Or there's the homemade pasta vongole, if you like seafood.
I love seafood, he said.
She began to relax, embracing the conversation rather than assessing Adam from afar, as if he was a habitual liar just dragged out of the cells. Lowering her defences never came easy, even more so now. The trouble was it had been so long since John. Comfortable, taciturn, self-contained John had slipped from her life to go back to London. She'd had no hint that he'd even been unhappy. Never a cross word, but then hardly a word at all. She had taken shocked months on her own before she realised she never even knew the man with whom she'd shared her life and her body for 2 years. The conversation flowed until the inevitable question.
So, Jan, your profile said you worked with social services.
Oh God, here we go. That's basically right.
So with adults or kids?
A bit of both, really. Of course, I spend my day like most of us do, behind the computer terminal bashing away on a keyboard. A bit boring, really. This was a line she had polished with all the previous dates. She wasn't going to tell him what she really did. Good God, no. Kiss of death on the first date, surely.
Here, tell me about it, he said. I'm a freelance web designer, so I know all about that. So, what about this kid that disappeared? Is that one of your responsibilities? He asked.
She didn't want to go there. I'm hoping that case doesn't fall to me. Alice Watkins, aged 7, had disappeared a day and a half ago. 1 minute she was playing near a static caravan where her parents were on holiday, gone the next. It had made the papers already, but was at this stage still primarily a uniform job, door to door, trawling the entire holiday park, where most cabins were at this time of year empty. Appeals for witnesses. But the anxiety had spread through the entire Barnstable office, amongst not only all the officers, but the receptionists too, and right through to the man who fixed the photocopier.
Well, fingers crossed she's found,
Adam said, as he called the waitress over. Yes. So I suppose you work from home?
I used to, but it was driving me mad, so I rented a shared office. I found it was important to be able to relax when I was at home, knowing I wasn't at work. Different headspaces. Know what I mean?
That smile again. They talked about music and found Latin jazz in common. He was impressed to hear that she ran, and even more impressed by the distances.
You regularly run 10 to 15K, he said.
It's not so far with practice. I'm a member of the Black Bull Harriers.
I used to run a bit and go to the gym, Bit more of a fair-weather exerciser. A jogger, not a runner, I suppose.
They ordered, and the food came quickly. She didn't even notice what she was eating.
Presumably you're not always stuck in the office. Client visits, tough council estates and so on, he asked.
This was good, and a nice change. The dating websites were crammed with conversational broadcasters who didn't listen, but simply waited for the next opportunity to talk. There was Brian, who had droned on and on about investment and pension strategies, and Aaron, who, while describing his software sales business, had stared almost without interruption at her peach-coloured jumper, as if he'd been gifted X-ray vision. Yes, I managed to get out yesterday. To sunny Woolacombe, she said. I can't tell you about the case, you know, data protection.
What had actually happened was that she'd been called to a vermin-infested house where an elderly man had died sitting on the toilet with his trousers round his ankles. There were signs of a break-in, but it wasn't clear whether it was related to the death. He smiled and nodded.
I spent yesterday trying to get images I'd been sent to configure correctly. Three worked perfectly, and the fourth kept overlapping the text. Took all day to figure out why. Sorry, it sounds so boring.
No, not at all. She excused herself and headed to the bathroom. She felt his eyes on her as she walked away, her unpracticed ankles trying not to fall off the heels. Maddie had persuaded her to wear the skirt, to show off those long, shapely legs, but Talantire realised now that, on a first date, it was a better idea not to distract his gaze. She wanted his eyes firmly on her face. Still, too late now. Once she was inside, she switched on her work phone out of pure workaholic habit. Shit. Three text messages and a voicemail from DC Stephen Dowling, who was on duty covering Barnstable and Ilfracombe tonight. Dowling was just 22, a probationer with NCID, and had been on one of her situational judgment training courses. He was a laggard, so she had mentored him informally for the first few months. But this was now getting a bit out of hand. She was on a date, for heaven's sake. With a sigh, she checked the voicemail.
Sorry to bother you when you're off duty, ma'am, but I'd appreciate a bit of help. I've got one uniform here and a dead body. She rang him. Ma'am, thanks for calling back.
His voice was high-pitched, squeaky almost, as he gabbled away.
We've got a big crime scene here in Ilfracombe, and I mean massive. I'm a bit out of my depth. D.I. Lockhart is the duty D.I., but he's stuck out in Snozzle and told me to get on with it.
St. Austell, locally known as Snozzle, was down into Cornwall, 2 hours' drive from Ilfracombe. What's happened?
We've got an elderly lady in a holiday home. She's been stabbed in the kitchen, blood everywhere.
She looked into the bathroom mirror, seeing tiny creases in her brow. The arrival of work mode. In the harsh light of the bathroom, her eyeshadow made her look like a panda, and at this rate, just as likely to get a mate.
Okay, don't touch anything.
Well, sorry, ma'am, I've been sick.
Please tell me, Stephen, not on the crime scene.
I got out as far as the hall. It's down my jacket, though.
She rolled her eyes.
Let me speak to the senior uniform.
There's only me and PC Moody at the moment.
That was worse news. Philip Moody was even more junior than Dowling, and notoriously dim with it. Talantire stared into the wash basin, seeing her date spiralling down the plug hole.
Oh, what about CSI? She asked.
I know they can't get here until morning. The main crew is in Exeter because there's been a hit and run with two injuries, and the second crew's still in Penzance.
That was 3 hours away from the crime scene. So it was to be another ruined Saturday night. The curse of Devon and Cornwall Police, a huge rural policing area, not a single motorway west of Exeter, and never enough officers.
All right, Stephen, I'll be there in half an hour.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It means a lot to me.
I'm not doing it to help you, Stephen. I'm doing it because it needs doing right. And if we get it done right now, that saves an awful lot of fuss and paperwork tomorrow. Is the crime scene secure?
Yes, it's taped off. We called a locksmith to get a padlock. He'll be along directly.
Good. Have you rung the duty forensic pathologist?
Yes, I'm waiting for confirmation whether he can come.
Have you taken some photos?
Yeah, but we've got new evidence markers.
But I take it you do have booties and gloves?
Gloves, yeah, but I got puke on the first pair and I suppose that's got my DNA in. We didn't know we needed booties when we first went in, so there is footprints and that.
Jan could only imagine what mess the crime scene might be in. Thank God she had only drunk half of her beer. She didn't like anyone smelling alcohol in her breath. She splashed water on her face and then, with rapid and practiced movements, used some cream and makeup removal pads to tone down the slap. She looked at the lipstick marks left on the tissues and wondered if she would ever see Adam again. She hoped so. Heading back into the restaurant, she saw him playing with his phone. He looked up and smiled, then did a double take at her emerging workaday face.
I'm really sorry, Adam. Something's come up at work. I have to go.
Really? He clearly didn't believe her and looked a little downcast.
Is it the little girl?
He asked, staring at his hands. It was almost as if he wanted it to be the case. Something definitely serious enough to justify abandoning the date. Anything, as long as it wasn't about him.
Look, I like you, and I think we should meet again, but I have some secrets I can't share with you right now.
She pulled out enough cash to cover what they'd eaten so far.
No, it's fine. I'll get it, he said.
No, you won't, I insist. I'll message you later in the week. As she left, she felt his eyes on her, not assessing her figure this time, but wondering whether she had told him the truth. That it clearly mattered to him was a good sign. Maybe not all was lost. Chapter 2. Ilfracombe was a sleepy Victorian coastal resort of around 10,000 people, 20 minutes north of Barnstable on a winding road. During its heyday, dozens of trains would arrive each day, disgorging thousands of holidaymakers from the Midlands and the North, eager to walk its cliffs and headlands and dip into the chilly waters. But by the 1960s, the European package holidays boom had begun. Like so many British seaside towns, Ilfracombe couldn't compete with the lure of Spanish and Greek beaches and their guaranteed warmth. The station closed in 1970, leaving the town a much more difficult place to get to. She used the hands-free phone to ring into the control room in Exeter to find out the state of play. The male call handler summarised what they knew so far.
Female, mid-60s, found stabbed in a rental property in Mercer Lane in the town centre. The alarm was raised by a neighbour who'd heard a violent argument on Thursday afternoon.
2 days ago?
Yes, and hadn't seen the lady emerge from the house. He knocked on the door this morning and again this afternoon and finally rung us on the non-emergency number shortly after 5. Our first officer, PC Moody, arrived at 8:15 p.m. and shortly after effected an entry.
And the rest, as they say, is histrionics.
Talantire thanked him, rang off and checked the time. The initial call was nearly 4 hours ago. Not an outrageously slow response for a non-emergency call. In some parts of the country, they were not answered at all. Fortunately, she always kept a go-bag of forensic coveralls, booties and gloves in her own car, as well as in her official unmarked vehicle. Next to it in the boot was a hold-all containing wellies, torch, DNA swabbing kit, yellow plastic evidence markers, and fingerprint lift gel strips. She raced out on the B3230, keeping to the speed limit, and within 20 minutes got her first sight of Ilfracombe from the hilltops above. She pulled over in a lay-by to unzip her skirt and wriggle into the pair of jeans she'd left on the back seat. She placed her high heels in the rear footwell and slid on her trainers. As she did so,
She took in the harbour lights twinkling in the dusk against a gunmetal sea, the town wedged between steep cliffs that resembled stacks of dark books sliding obliquely into the water. It took only another 5 minutes to get to the crime scene. Mercer Lane was a very steep and narrow residential street in the town centre, leading up from Wilder Road towards the High Street, to which it was connected by an alleyway. Parking was difficult, and the two squad cars already there were blocking the road right up at the top. She left her vehicle behind them and made her way up through the sizeable crowd of rubberneckers to the crime tape. 5 uniformed officers were visible. Amongst them she recognised the looming presence of Inspector T.P. Carnegie and heaved a sigh of relief. Known universally as Wigwam, because of his first two initials, Carnegie was 6'2", mid-50s, and bespectacled, with thinning hair. He was operationally a safe pair of hands, if only he would keep them to himself in the office. "Never turn your back on Wigwam," was one of the first pieces of advice she was offered when she'd started at Barnstable 5 years ago. To be fair, Wigwam was much better behaved these days after her robust deputy, Detective Sergeant Maddie Moran, had had words with him a year ago. But a reputation like that, once earned, wasn't easily lost. Carnegie was talking to Dowling and Moody, gathered right at the top of the cul-de-sac around the entrance to a substantial stone-built cottage with a steep wooden gable tucked in behind a 3-storey Victorian building on the High Street above. It was Bluebird Cottage, according to the glazed tile sign outside, and incorporated a much older, narrow building, recessed to the right, whose arched wooden door stood slightly ajar.
"Very kind of you to turn up on your evening off, Jan," Carnegie said.
"That's all right, I wasn't doing anything much."
"We're a bit stretched here."
"Wretched, I heard." Carnegie rolled his eyes in agreement. The smell of vomit by the doorway was overpowering. She glanced at Dowling, who looked decidedly sheepish. His borrowed stab vest didn't completely conceal the damp zip-up fleece jacket that still bore some traces. "Who's been inside?" she asked him.
"Just us two," Dowling said.
"Show me your holiday snaps, then."
"It's pretty ghastly,"
Dowling said, passing across his phone. She swiped through 6 images. A blood-drenched woman was lying spread-eagled but fully dressed on a kitchen table, with 6 inches of a crude iron crucifix protruding from her chest. She blinked away her shock. "Right, I'll go and suit up."
"I'll sign you in then, ma'am," said
PC Moody, shrugging a clipboard.
"The tent should be here in 30 minutes.
"The sooner the better," she said. 5 minutes later, now wearing her Tyvek coveralls, gloves and booties, and armed with packs of fingerprint gel lifts and swabs, Jan made her way back through the growing crowd, past the uniformed officers and up the step. She eased the old wooden door open, and it creaked like something from a Hammer film. It was an unusual cottage, that was for sure. A short hallway, with a kitchen off left, but her eye was drawn to the long lounge with a high vaulted ceiling and tall, narrow ecclesiastical windows at the far end. It looked like a converted church. To the right, a spiral metal staircase led up to a galleried bedroom with a balcony looking out over the hallway and lounge. The flagstone floor was marked with bloody footprints from what might well be constabulary boots, as well as the spattered remains of Dowling's lunch. Before moving in, she took a gel lift from the light switch by the door and followed it with a DNA swab. She didn't have any stepping plates, but carefully placed her feet around the right-hand edge of the hallway. There were 2 women's coats on the coat rack, and she took fibre lifts from the collars. She moved forward methodically, taking samples as she went, finishing with the round brass handle of the door to the kitchen, from where the bloody footprints originated. Only then did she allow herself to ease open the door and take in the horror and stench of the crime scene. As she stepped inside, a couple of metallic green flies buzzed away to the ceiling, fat and lazy, well-fed. The poor woman had been gagged with a pair of tights, and her eyes were slightly open, only the whites visible. There was evidence she had lost control of her bowels in her final moments of life. The crude metal of the cross looked like it may have pinned the victim to the table, leaving her limbs dangling. Her fingers were bloody, as if in death she had desperately tried to reverse her impalement. Images of a dozen vampire films flitted like shadows through Talantire's mind, adolescent fears urging her to flee. Others had opposite impulses. The wound, small, blood-dark and sticky, drew back a fly which crawled on it, then meticulously rubbed its forelimbs one around the other, as thorough as a surgeon soaping up for an operation. The urge to swat the creature away out of some misplaced sense of hygiene was almost irresistible. Jan set down plastic evidence markers, then concentrated on taking pictures, more than 100 images for this room alone. She crouched for low angles and stood on tiptoe for top-down perspectives, swallowing back bile that tried to force its way into her throat. Under the table, she spotted a handbag and retrieved it, putting it into a plastic evidence bag. She wondered what evidence could be secured that might deteriorate before CSI's eventual arrival. There was one crucial element: time of death. The longer the delay, the harder it can be to establish exactly when the victim has died. Though there are standard countdown calculators of time against body temperature, these can be thrown by environmental factors. If the ambient temperature changes, say the central heating comes on, a body may retain heat for longer. She looked around the kitchen. A rather swish, newly installed set of cupboards, worktops and drawers. Hardwood. A well-equipped rental, with lots of money spent. Loads of pans hanging from ceiling hooks. Brabantio utensils on a wall rack. Knives, lots of them. This wasn't just domestic envy. It gave her an idea. She did fingerprint lifts of the two principal drawers before sliding them open. Bingo. She was right. A meat thermometer. This was a brand new digital device with a steel probe the size of a darning needle. She turned it on, then noted the room temperature, 16 degrees centigrade. Carefully, she approached the body, hoping that she wasn't going to get into trouble with the forensic pathologist for making a fresh hole in the victim. Still, without a probe that only a CSI team would have, this was the only way to get to this vital information. With her gloved hand, she lifted a section of unbloodied blouse, exposing the woman's waist. She rested a thumb against the pale skin. Cool, but not cold. Flexible, so presumably beyond rigor mortis. She took a photograph of the unblemished skin before pressing in the long probe to its full depth. She waited while the digital readout temperature climbed. Then, when it had stabilized, she photographed the display. It showed 19.2 degrees centigrade, about half a living body temperature. She'd have to look it up precisely, but it didn't seem out of kilter with the witness statement reporting hearing the noise of an argument 2 days ago. That could well have been when she died. She was just wondering what else she could do when the phone rang. Detective Superintendent Michael Wells, her boss.
Hello, Jan. Thank you for giving up your Saturday night to help us out here.
I'd like not to make a habit of it, she said, looking at the impaled body in front of her. I'd rather be sitting at home watching Strictly.
Well, as you are aware, we are having a resourcing crisis.
That's been true for as long as I've been in the police service, sir. With all due respect, I think it's high time that the police and crime commissioner managed to get us some more resources. Half the time we've got one overnight duty DI covering the entire region. It's not enough.
I hear what you're saying, Jan. DC Nuttall is coming in to take over from midnight, so you're off the hook until tomorrow. Now, about this body.
I was getting garbled reports about a crucifix, of all things.
Well, whatever else was garbled, it wasn't that, sir. This is the clearest case of murder I've ever seen. We need CSI here as soon as you can possibly get them, along with the duty forensic pathologist.
Well, we've got a couple of crime scene investigators on their way now. I understand Dr. Piers Holcomb will be there by 8 a.m. It sounds like we need to keep the body in situ until he arrives. And, Jan, I'd like you to be SIO. Nuttall, Carnegie and the uniforms will hold the fort overnight, but I'd like you to be in charge by the time Dr. Holcomb arrives.
All right, sir. She had been due the whole weekend off, but had accepted from the first moment she started removing her makeup in the Royal Oak that she was going to be hard at work until her scheduled duties resumed on Monday. Talantire looked around to ensure she hadn't brought anything into the crime scene apart from the evidence markers. She then carefully retraced her steps. Emerging outside into the narrow street, she was blinded by the flash guns of the press. Though kept back a good 20 yards by the crime tape, they were using their long lens cameras to good effect. What they really needed was a good crime scene tent, so they could work around the cottage entrance unobserved. As things stood, residents were staring out of upstairs windows opposite and could see exactly who came and went. There were a dozen uniformed constables present now, along with Inspector Carnegie. She called him over. "We're going to need to have the houses opposite cleared. We can't have all these people gawking down at us. And seeing how cramped the street is, we won't be able to get the mobile incident room down here."
"I've already made arrangements for tomorrow," Carnegie said, pointing up the alleyway. "We're taking over the Stag and Hounds Hotel on the High Street. I've notified the pub company."
Jan remembered a good night in the Stag well over a decade ago, when she and fellow trainee Caroline had gone, off duty, to see some heavy metal band and got very drunk with the locals. They only narrowly escaped being arrested when the police arrived after a window got broken outside. "That should be perfect. Refreshment on tap," she said.
"Sorry to disappoint. It's closed for refurbishment, though they haven't yet started on it. There's no booze on the premises."
"Spoil sports," she said.
"It'll be ready first thing, and it's only 50 yards from the scene."
"Great. I'll ring Nuttall to brief him. Then I'm heading off home for a bit of shut-eye."
"Thanks for coming in, Jan. Much appreciated."
He pointed to a bin bag by the side of a patrol car.
"Stick your overalls in there."
She passed him the evidence bag containing the handbag. "I hope there is some ID in there. We need to find out who she is."
"The landlady's emailing me the rental contract. Tenant wasn't a local, apparently. Been here 7 or 8 months.
He shrugged the bag.
"I've appointed one of the PCSOs as evidence officer until tomorrow. He only did the course last week."
As Jan walked away towards her car, she reflected how few experienced officers there were around. Everyone seemed to be straight off a training course. It's all very well getting to use the latest gizmos, but there is no substitute for experience. When she was inside the vehicle, she checked her personal phone for messages on the dating app. Nothing from Adam. Oh well, probably the end of that. They hadn't even swapped surnames, so at least her cover was intact. She drove home and got in about 10:45. She was just cleaning her teeth when her phone buzzed. A message through the dating app from Adam. "Hi, hope work wasn't too onerous. Meet up again next week?" She grinned into the mirror, a little beard of white foam dripping from her chin. Chapter 3. It was shortly before 8 on Sunday morning, and Ilfracombe High Street looked like the epicentre of a localised recession. Apart from the Lidl, there were no national names, not even a Boots, just a run-down nightclub, a couple of tatty convenience stores, some charity shops, and one brave bookshop. This was the rotting heart of an otherwise pretty and apparently prosperous seaside town. But the gap between well-heeled holiday homeowners and the struggling locals was obvious.
Oxford Grove, a steep street leading up to Princess Avenue Police Station, was a perfect case in point. Wonderful Victorian architecture, now utterly neglected, with piles of rubbish outside each of the front doors. She had sometimes been here on drugs raids. Talantire parked at the bottom of Oxford Grove, opposite the Stag and Hounds. As she got out of the car, she saw the rest of her team arrive. Detective Sergeant Maddie Moran and DC Dave Nuttall, both from the Barnstable team, along with a new officer, wearing a trouser suit and a fawn hijab, emerged from the unmarked Ford.
Jan, this is Primrose Chen. She's the new digital evidence officer, Maddie said. Joining us from the Met, no less.
Maddie was stockily built, with her dark hair cut in a bob that framed her heart-shaped face. She was 36, a couple of years younger than her boss.
Welcome, Primrose, Talantire said. You've caught us on a very busy day, so you'll be straight into the action.
Talantire had been notified of Primrose's appointment, but wasn't expecting her for another week or so because of training. The young DEO had only served 6 months in London and had previously worked in the US.
That's perfectly fine, she said, with a slight American accent. I like to be busy.
Then you'll love CID, said Nuttall. His trademark leather jacket was unzipped to reveal a denim shirt that matched his ripped jeans. He was, as usual, chewing gum. He was late 40s, with thick framed glasses, dyed dark hair slicked back like a superannuated teddy boy.
Where's Wigwam? Jan asked Maddie.
He's going to join us later on.
Seeing the puzzled expression on Primrose's face, Maddie explained how the uniformed inspector had gained his nickname.
What you'll find, Primrose, is that it's best not to use nicknames to people's faces. Especially if your nickname is Wanker, Nuttall interjected.
Maddie and Jan shared a glance. Primrose's face had coloured slightly as she glanced towards Nuttall.
Don't worry, he's just trying to be funny, Jan said. Of course, we'd never use that as a nickname, Primrose, Maddie whispered, leaning towards her. The reason being that there are no end of wankers in Devon and Cornwall police, and we wouldn't know who you were talking about. They all laughed.
Right, let's get this show on the road, Jan said.
Nuttall had the keys and let them into the pub through the side door, and it all came flooding back to her. The smell of stale beer, the sticky carpet with its paisley pattern designed to hide the stains, the hand pumps and the taps, this week's guest ale or cider sensation. Above them, a nicotine-stained ceiling with its exposed mock beams. The round tables with curlicue cast iron legs, perfect for smashing your shins on and far too heavy to throw. The jukebox was gone, replaced by a quiz machine. There was no sign of the pool table either. Maddie went to the windows and drew the curtains, while Nuttall and Primrose brought in whiteboards, magnets, paper and marker pens from the car outside. Jan set up a laptop and projector screen, and in 10 minutes they were ready to run.
Right, I can confirm that Dr. Holcomb is there now, Jan said, looking at her phone where a text message was displayed.
She opened an envelope and pulled out a sheaf of photo enlargements, fixing them to the whiteboard with magnets. Right at the centre, she put a shocking image of the poor woman impaled by the crucifix, gagged and drenched in blood.
It's like something from a horror film, Nuttall said.
Talantire agreed.
Maybe there were ritual elements.
She hoped not. Lurid press reportage always followed anything with satanic overtones.
That crucifix looks pretty crude, Maddie said. Two massive iron nails and a load of blobby solder. Those blobs are probably bronze or lead, Nuttall said. Is it intended to be Christ?
Presumably, Talantire said, pinning up a close-up image of the murder weapon.
Those runnels could be arms on the cross and the biggest blob could be a head.
The legs are quite convincing, if you squint a bit,
Maddie said. For a Year 5 metalwork project, anyway.
For all the dark humour, Talantire knew not one of the team, not her, probably not even the most experienced officers in the entire force, had ever seen anything like this. The juxtaposition of the most holy symbol in Christianity with an unspeakable act of brutality. For a few moments, they all just stared, taking it in. Breaking the spell, Talantire exhaled and laid out half a dozen clear plastic evidence bags. Mobile phone, purse with bank cards, passport, all the usual stuff, but no driving license. She is Mrs. Ruth Lyle, aged 66, formerly of 106 Alexandra Terrace, Exeter. According to the landlady, she'd been living here since June last year.
I'll do a financial check, Maddie said, and follow up all the ID information.
Good. Primrose, I need to get inside that phone and find out who had been messaging her. Any images or videos, and, of course, the movements of that phone in the last 14 days.
Okay, Primrose said. I am told that you now have a data kiosk in Barnstable. Otherwise, I'll have to send it to Exeter.
Yes, we got a spanking new Aceso Dual, although hardly anybody knows how to use it yet.
Wow, that's a cool device. It can be used in the field as well as a desktop. I'm quite familiar with it.
Good, Talantire said. Dave, I want you to liaise with the uniforms. Your immediate task is finding next of kin. I also want you to find out everything you can about the building. Who had access, where the keys were kept, and run a criminal background check on the landlady, plus an elimination DNA sample.
Right, boss, I'm on it, he said.
Finally, we need to find any CCTV in the area. The assailant could only have come from two directions, and there must be some coverage. I'll be asking Inspector Carnegie to coordinate that. Ah, speak of the devil. Carnegie arrived in his usual baggy uniform. His dark tie so badly knotted, it didn't lie flat on his shirt.
I'm sorry I'm late, Jan. It's taken a while to persuade the neighbours opposite the crime scene to vacate their house.
He glanced at the whiteboard, the photographs and the name of the victim now written up in marker pen.
Ruth Lyle? That's a bit of a coincidence.
Why?
It's the same name as a young girl who was murdered in the town half a century ago.
Nuttall snorted with derision and began to chuckle.
Carnegie fixed him with a stare.
Have you not heard of the famous case, Nuttall? I would have thought a sharp sleuth like you would be aware of some of the criminal history of this county.
Nuttall shrugged and continued chewing.
Well, hardly the same person, is it? Obviously not. But I was brought up here in Ilfracombe, and my father was the coroner at that time, and I can tell you that the crucifix murder was a pretty big deal in 1973.
Did you say crucifix? Talantire asked. She removed one of the enlargements on the whiteboard and handed it to the inspector. Our victim was impaled with this, which to me looks like a crucifix.
Good Lord,
Carnegie said, and grabbed a seat back to steady himself.
Dowling said she was stabbed with a big nail.
Good God. He went pale. Hold on a second, said Maddie Moran, typing at her laptop.
Yes, there it is. In the Devon Argus newspaper database, headlined the Devon Vampire Murder. It says Ruth Lyle was 16 when she was found dead on April Fool's Day 1973 with a crucifix in her heart.
Hang on, that's exactly 50 years last Thursday, Talantire said. Maddie continued.
The crime was unsolved for 2 months until a youth by the name of Gawain Entwistle confessed to the killing. Entwistle, a neighbour of the victim, was considered retarded.
Nuttall sucked his teeth.
Can't say that nowadays.
Learning difficulties, Talantire said.
And was sentenced to life imprisonment, Maddie continued.
They were all staring at Carnegie, who looked like he was in shock.
Are you all right? Talantire asked.
I just cannot believe this, he muttered. That case devastated Ilfracombe. The entire community was in shock, and now, 50 years later...
He stared back at the whiteboard, his eyes glazed.
It would be a very long time for a copycat killer to wait, Nuttall said.
True, Talantire said. Nuttall might be annoying, but there was nothing wrong with his detective antennae. Carnegie was holding the photograph and his hands were shaking.
I just can't believe this. I was only 6 when it happened, but my mother told me that this case almost destroyed their marriage.
Listen to this, Maddie said. The original killing took place in the Dimpsey Chapel.
Where is that? She turned to Carnegie.
I've heard of it, but I don't think it exists now, Wigwam said. Probably demolished after the killing.
Primrose was busy at her laptop.
I found a record online from the Ilfracombe Civic Society. The Dimpsey Chapel was originally known as St. James Without. She looked up. Such crazy names in this country.
Without what? Nuttall asked. It probably means St. James without St. Philip, Carnegie said. The reason being, there is another church near the promenade called St. Philip and St. James, or as it is known locally, Pip and Jim's.
Dimpsey is Devon slang for shaded or dusky, Talantire said.
Maddie was busy on her laptop as they were talking.
St. James Without is on a map from the local antiquarians. I just found it. She squinted at the screen. You can't zoom in much, but it's also on Mercer Lane, number 4, so it must be very close to Bluebird Cottage, which is number 8.
I found some press pictures from the time, Nuttall said, pointing to his laptop screen. 2 or 3 of the buildings in the lane had been demolished, but this is the same wrought iron lamp sticking out of the wall.
Talantire looked over his shoulder. The picture showed a press of helmeted police around an arched doorway into a narrow stone wall. There was a number by the door, and by zooming in, Nuttall identified it as a 4.
Okay, so it was number 4 Mercer Lane. It doesn't look like a historic church. All right, there is one easy way to sort this out.
She grabbed her coat, which had been lying on the bar behind the whiteboard.
Come on, everyone. School trip.
1 minute later, the assembled detectives made their way out of the incident room into the high street, carefully locking the door behind them. They made their way right and then down the alleyway into Mercer Lane. A female PC guarded the lane, closed off by an arc of blue crime tape. 10 yards beyond it was a CSI van, behind which a white tent was connected to the front of the cottage. A few passers-by were taking selfies.
Has Dr. Holcomb been? Talantire asked the PC.
The forensic pathologist? Yes, he just left a few minutes ago. The body has been removed, but there are 2 CSI staff still inside.
Someone called from the tape barrier, a good-looking young man in a bomber jacket and jeans.
Hi, detective. I'm Tim Harvey, North Devon News. Can you tell me what happened here?
No comment, Nuttall muttered back.
Is it true there's been a murder?
The detectives ignored him and ducked under the tape, then made their way along the lane until they were opposite Bluebird Cottage. The historic Victorian-style lamp protruded from the wall high up to the left of the door. Nuttall, who now had the 1973 photograph on his phone, held it up to show Talantire.
Looks like the same place, he said.
Talantire almost felt faint at the revelation.
This just cannot be true. A girl called Ruth Lyle was killed here in 1973, and then 50 years later, almost to the day, a woman of the same name is killed with a similar murder weapon at the same location.
Chapter 4.
It's a curious object and no mistake,
CSI evidence technician Pavel Kaminsky said to Jan Talantire, as he led her from Barnstable Criminal Investigation Department on the first floor, through the CSI office and into the adjacent evidence room, where items from current investigations were stored. Kaminsky unlocked the knife cabinet and pulled open the metal door. This cupboard held three rows of knives, perhaps 50 in total, some bloodied, some clean, each in a screw-top plastic tube. Each weapon had been seized from an individual, discovered at a crime scene, or removed from a body, dead or alive. They included a shelf with a samurai-style sword seized from a recently released psychiatric patient in Woolacombe, a wicked-looking multi-bladed zombie knife used in a playground altercation over a vaping kit in Plymouth, and a sharpened machete found during a drug raid in Torbay. Here were the tools of dispute in 21st century Britain. Amongst this rack of ruination, the crucifix seemed incongruous and almost innocent. The width of the crossbar meant it was in the widest available container, and Pavel needed two hands to lift it from the shelf.
With the square cross-section and the raised square heads, these look to me like medieval nails. I don't think it's actually intended to be a crucifix. It just happens to look curiously like a Christ figure because of the way the blobs of molten lead cooled and ran down the larger nail.
Kaminsky, a balding man with gingery stubble, stood the tube on a desk, unscrewed the top, and in nitrile-gloved hands, lifted it out and under his desk inspection lamp.
So it's not homemade? Well, not recently, I would say. It's certainly grimy.
Inspector Carnegie reckoned that the one used in the original murder was the prized possession of St. James Without, she said. Some local dignitary apparently brought it back from the Crusades. Kaminsky peered closer, using a magnifying glass.
I doubt it. If it was really 1,000 years old, there presumably would be corrosion.
The dazzling light clearly showed 3 inches of dried blood at the bottom end of the foot-long vertical iron nail.
I took 3 or 4 swabs of the blood when it was still wet, Kaminsky continued, and a couple on the shaft, plus 2 on the crossbeam where you would expect someone to hold it if using it as a weapon. If there is any DNA on there, we'll find it. Then we used gel lifters for fingerprints, but couldn't find anything.
What other tests could we do on it? Talantire asked. Kaminsky scratched his head.
I'm sure the historians would love us to do a proper metallurgical analysis, an X-ray, and even a carbon dating test. I'm sure that's never been done, seeing as it was out of circulation after the original murder.
Pavel, let's be clear. From a criminal forensic point of view, we don't much care whether it was brought back from the Crusades or hammered together in 1970 by a schoolboy in a garage in Torbay. The only relevant question is whether it's the same one used to kill Ruth Lyle in 1973, the same one that should from then onwards have been kept in police custody.
True, Kaminsky said.
Personally, I think I'd prefer if it was a homemade one, Talantire said. Then we won't have to explain quite how the police managed to lose it from a secure evidence store.
Well, we'd best look after it, eh? He said,
replacing it and screwing the plastic lid on the container.
I'm the evidence officer, so I think it should stay in the cutlery cupboard with the other weapons.
Talantire had left a message with Dr. Holcomb, asking for some initial impressions. He rang back as she was driving back from Barnstable to Ilfracombe, and she took the call on the hands-free.
Morning, Dr. Holcomb.
Good morning, Detective Inspector.
His voice was pure Home Counties, honeyed with self-confidence.
A bit of an unpleasant scene, wasn't it, Piers?
Well, there's not too many pleasant ones in my line of work, but yes, it was a tad grisly. I removed the crucifix and gave it to your CSI team to take samples from. The victim seemed to have been killed in the same position she was found, with a single 38mm penetration wound that looked to have pierced the left ventricle of the heart. This all is, of course, subject to confirmation at post-mortem,
which I won't be able to do until Tuesday afternoon, I'm afraid.
I'm sure we'll cope with that, Talantire said.
Holcombe was relatively young, new in the area, but had been qualified for 6 years. Based on previous dealings with him, she trusted his judgment. Still, 2 days was a long time to wait.
By the way, thank you for the temperature reading. That's extremely helpful for the time of death, which does accord with Thursday afternoon. I understood you took it with a meat thermometer.
Yes, necessity is the mother of invention.
That's very resourceful. Now, how are you doing on the identification? He asked.
We've got a name and plenty of confirmation documents. But the thing is...
Yes, I'm guessing that you're alluding to the historic crime. Same name, same type of murder weapon, one of your CSI officers told me. That's going to automatically make it more high profile, I assume.
No doubt, Talantire replied. We're not revealing the fact she has the same name. Still, handling the PR is above my pay grade.
Definitely above mine, Holcombe said.
I've got a call into Middlemore to find out where the original paperwork for the 1973 killing would be. Once we can see exactly what happened then, we can see if there's any connection.
Middlemore was the headquarters of the Devon and Cornwall Police in Exeter.
Good luck with that. In any case, you won't have any DNA records back then. However, if you are fortunate enough to locate the original evidence bags, then it would be possible to test the contents using today's technology.
Yes, I've been thinking about that, Talantire said. Still, the first priority is to find out who our current victim is.
Talantire ended the call as she arrived at the Stag and Hounds. Once inside, Nuttall called her over to his screen.
I've just had a PCSO go round to the victim's former address in Exeter. It's a rental place, a bit basic apparently. The landlord says Mrs. Lyle had the place for a couple of years. The neighbours are students and most of them haven't been there very long.
Okay, said Talantire. Let's go round there tomorrow morning, see what we can discover. But first, let's meet the landlady of Bluebird Cottage.
How long have you owned Bluebird Cottage, Mrs. Lee? Talantire asked.
She and DC Maddie Moran were sitting in the comfortable lounge of the owner. Wendy Lee, whose real name was Huan Ying Lee, was a tiny little bright-eyed bird of a woman in her 70s.
About 4 years. My husband died, and we closed takeaway, sell all.
She glanced out of the window of her home, which gave a good view over the harbour and the late afternoon light. She was clearly contemplating happier times.
We put the money in property, 2 places in this town. Set up with Airbnb. My son help.
Is he here?
Whittle.
Talantire initially thought she was referring to his mental health, but then realised she'd given him a location, Bristol.
So, just to be clear, Bluebird Cottage was already modernised when you bought it?
Yes. But according to the land registry, it was number 4 Mercer Lane when you bought it, and now it's number 8, Maddie said. Number 4 is very unlucky. Number 8 is lucky. The number still in sequence and on correct side of road, so no problem. Original number 6 and 8 were knocked down and made into garages.
Did you know about the crime in 1973? Talantire asked.
Of course. Everyone know. My husband come to Britain from Hong Kong 2 years before and open restaurant 1 month before killing.
So, March 1973?
Yes. Years later, when property for sale, 4 years ago, we remind vendor about murder. We got it cheap, very cheap.
She made it sound like chip, cheap as chips.
So what did you know about Mrs. Lyle?
The lady is good tenant. She offered to take cottage for 2 years if we lower rent. It seem good deal. As last year, it always empty in winter. She pay 3 month deposit, and she no trouble. No party, no damage, no dog or cat. Perfect lady, very nice.
And very dead, thought Talantire. Did she tell you why she'd come to the area?
No.
There is only a short-term previous address on the lease, Maddie said. Why did you accept that?
Because she pay cash up front. Beside, she know Ilfracombe, and she know my restaurant on Hillsborough Road.
She knew it. Was that Dragon House? Talantire asked.
Yes, my husband little joke, she said, smiling. Me, the dragon lady. New owner change. It now gate of Asia. Indian, Thai and Chinese.
She laughed.
I say, make up your mind.
When did you open first and when was it sold? Talantire asked.
Open on auspicious day, Monday, March 5, year of ox. Good for grand opening, for prayer, for good luck.
Mrs. Lee suddenly snapped her fingers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.